eigen values and eigen vectors of matrices and linear transformations. Let me just recall a few concepts here which are important, and then we will begin with the new material. Okay, so we have a matrix A which is having entries in the field of scalars, and suppose this is a square matrix of size n by n. Then a non-zero vector v, so that AV equal to lambda v, where lambda is some scalars and v is a vector, it's a column vector, okay, and it is non-zero. Then this v is called eigenvector and lambda is called eigenvalue. So the matrix A, suppose this was real matrix and 2x2 matrix, then this matrix A gives rise to a map linear transformation from R2 to R2. And so it takes input as a vector and output is another vector. But if I have an eigenvector, suppose v is this eigenvector, then v is taken on the same line and it is multiplied by lambda. This lambda can be zero, it is a real number. If it is having the field of scalars as f, then lambda has to be a member of f. Eigenvalue has to be a member of the scalar field that you fix in the beginning. But v is mapped to lambda v. And so, but this map W mapping to AW is a linear transformation. So all vectors on this line, they are mapped to this lambda times the same vector. So every vector on this line is being scaled by an amount lambda, and lambda can be zero also. Okay, lambda can be zero also. So if lambda is zero, then this entire line, okay, which contains V, is shrunk to a point. If lambda is not equal to zero, then this line, which is the linear span of V, is mapped to itself under the action of the linear transformation which is induced by A. So the line is mapped to itself in A, and if lambda is not equal to zero, it is a one-to-one map from the line which is spanned by V to the line which is spanned by V not two. Okay, so V is eigenvector, and it is giving you directions which are preserved by the action of the linear transformation. Okay, it can be in degenerate case, the entire line can be mapped to zero vector alone when lambda equal to zero. So eigenvalues and eigenvectors have this geometric interpretation, and then we learned how to find the eigenvalues. So if AV equal to lambda V, that says that A minus lambda times identity matrix times V equal to zero. This V is a non-zero vector, and this is a homogeneous system of linear equation. This is a homogeneous system of linear equations. Once I substitute value of lambda, okay, then since there is a non-zero vector V in the null space of A minus lambda I, A minus lambda I is invertible matrix. Yeah, I mean, this is a singular matrix. Okay, this is singular matrix. It is not invertible, because invertible matrices will not map non-zero vector to zero vector. So A minus I lambda I is not invertible. Where it is a square matrix, that means determinant of A minus lambda I is equal to zero. So we define the characteristic polynomial of a square matrix A as the determinant of xi minus A. This is the characteristic polynomial, and in some books, roots of the characteristic polynomial, they are called characteristic values of the matrix. but very often we call them as eigenvalues. So if lambda is a root of the characteristic polynomial, and lambda is a scalar over which we are considering all our matrices, then lambda is called eigenvalue. Otherwise, it is not called an eigenvalue, right? If you are considering a real vector space and a linear transformation on that real vector space, then only real numbers can be eigenvalues. Complex numbers will not be called eigenvalues. Okay, but if I take the complex, if I consider complex matrices, yeah, then the determinant of xi minus a, this is a polynomial, this is the characteristic polynomial of a, this is a degree n polynomial, degree n polynomial with complex coefficients, so it has n roots. Okay, PAX has n complex roots. But counting with multiplicities. So if I fix my field of scalars as field of complex numbers, then every matrix has eigenvalue. But if I only look at, say, real matrices, then matrices may not have any eigenvalues. For example, if you consider the matrix of rotation by angle theta, which is different from 0 or 2 pi, this is the matrix of rotation by angle theta. Okay. So if every vector is being rotated by theta, then no line is mapping to itself. Yeah, no line is mapping. Every line is being rotated by angle theta, and therefore there are no eigenvectors of the rotation matrix. Okay, there are no eigenvectors. The presence of eigenvector means that there is a line. There is a one-dimensional subspace which is mapped to itself by the action of the matrix or the linear transformation. But rotation is not fixing any line. It is rotating every line by theta amount. So no line is mapped to itself, and therefore there are no eigenvalues and no eigenvectors of this matrix. Although it's a real matrix, yeah, cos theta, sin theta, minus sin theta, cos theta, they are real numbers. It's a real matrix. It has no real eigenvalues. Yeah, but if I look at the quadratic polynomial with complex coefficients, then I know that every quadratic polynomial with complex coefficients has in general two roots. So there will always be a complex eigenvalue of this rotation matrix. And we found those eigenvalues. These were e to the power I theta and e to the power minus I theta. Okay. So once I locate an eigenvalue lambda in the field of scalars, then I look at all the vectors so that AV equal to lambda V. Or if T is a linear transformation, then I look at all the vectors so that TV is equal to lambda V. Okay. So if TV equal to lambda V and T is a linear transformation from a vector space to itself, then also we say if this V is non-zero and lambda is in the field of scalars, we say V is an eigenvector. So look at this set. This is called the eigenspace of A or T corresponding to eigenvalue lambda. So it is all vectors V so that AV equal to lambda V, or all vectors V so that TV equal to lambda V. So this is an eigenspace because if I take two vectors which are eigenvectors, their sum is also an eigenvector with the same eigenvalue. Yeah. So with every eigenvalue, I have this eigenspace. And we also saw that the eigenspace corresponding to distinct eigenvalues, if I have two distinct eigenvalues, lambda and mu are distinct, then their intersection is only the zero vector. Okay, the intersection is only the zero vector. So any two eigenspaces, they intersect only in the zero vector. And so by the dimension formula for the sum of two subspaces, if I take these two subspaces, which are eigenspaces, okay, then the dimension of their sum of these two subspaces, okay, is the sum of the dimension because the intersection is the zero vector. So E lambda A plus dimension of E mu A. And we also proved that if I take distinct eigenvalues and I pick a eigenvector from each eigenspace, then these are linearly independent. Okay, eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are linearly independent. So therefore, because the action on eigenvectors is very simple. Linear transformation may be complicated, yeah, but the action on these directions which are produced by eigenvectors, this is an eigenvector with eigenvalue lambda 1, this is an eigenvector with eigenvalue lambda 2, etc., then these directions are important. They are we have many lines which are mapped to themselves, okay, and they are linearly independent directions. Okay, if lambda i's are distinct, they are linearly independent directions. So it will be very nice if I have a basis of the vector space on which my matrix is acting, or the linear transformation is acting, or consisting of eigenvectors. Yeah. So if T is my linear transformation from V to V and dimension of V equal to n, then it will be very nice to have eigenvectors which form a basis of V. Because once I know action of a linear transformation on basis vectors, I know its action on every vector because it's a linear transformation. But on the eigenvectors, the action of a matrix is very simple. AVI equal to lambda VI for every I. And this is a basis. So if I fix this basis, V1 up to Vn, yeah, and then look at the matrix of the linear map, okay, matrix of the linear map with respect to this basis. So take the linear map which is induced by A, but now rather than taking the standard basis, I take the basis of eigenvectors. Then the matrix of this linear transformation is going to be diagonal matrix, because AV1 is lambda 1, AV1 is lambda 1 V1, and therefore the coordinate vector of AV1 with respect to B is simply lambda 1 0 0. Then if I apply this linear transformation on V2, it is lambda 2 V2. So coordinate vector of the image of V2 under action of TA is 0 lambda 2 0, etc. So this turned out to be diagonal matrix. This is the diagonal matrix whose diagonal entries are eigenvalues. Yeah. So my linear transformation may be very complicated, huge matrix, yeah, lots of entries. But if I can identify a basis of eigenvectors and then switch from the standard basis to the basis of eigenvectors, then the matrix of the linear map induced by the matrix with respect to the basis of eigenvectors is a diagonal matrix. And that diagonal matrix is the simplest matrix you can think of. So that's the advantage of working with an eigenbasis. And so we are interested in knowing when there is a basis of eigenvectors. Yeah, there may be no eigenvectors, like we saw the real matrix, 2x2 real matrix. There are no eigenvectors. So there is no question of a basis of eigenvectors for the rotation matrix, if you think of this as a real matrix. But if you think of this as a complex matrix, of course, there are two eigenvalues, e to the power I theta, e to the power minus I theta. They are complex conjugates of each other. They are roots of a quadratic polynomial. So there will be a basis of eigenvectors. So if I look at the linear transformation, which is rotation by theta from R2 to R2, okay, then the matrix of R theta as a map from R2 to R2, yeah, it doesn't get simplified because there are no eigenvalues, real eigenvalues. But if I think of the matrix operating on C2, then there are two eigenvalues, e to the power I theta, e to the power minus I theta. And if theta is not zero, these are distinct, and eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are linearly independent. In fact, the eigenvector for e to the power I theta turns out to be 1 I1, and this corresponds to 1 minus I, something like that. So these are two eigenvectors which are in fact mutually perpendicular. because their dot product is zero. Okay, so having a basis of eigenvectors is very good for a linear transformation, and we want to now identify what are these matrices, what are these linear transformation which possess a basis of eigenvectors. Yeah, you will see later that these things arise in applications very often. Immediately in the next course on differential equations, you will see that there are many differential equations whose solutions form eigenfunctions. Okay, they form eigenfunctions, and the differential equation acts as a linear operator. Okay, and there are many other situations where eigenvectors acquire a concrete meaning. Eigenvalues and eigenvectors acquire a concrete meaning, and we will see applications of eigenvalues in data fitting problem. So I talked about least square approximations last time, and we will come back to it, and I will show you how using eigenvalues we can approximate functions by polynomials or trigonometric polynomials like sine x, cosine x, sine 2x, cosine 2x, etc. So the eigenvalues and eigenvectors, they are very important from application point of view. So we want to understand when does a matrix have a basis of eigenvectors. Yeah, and so if at all there is a basis of eigenvectors, I form a matrix whose column vectors are eigenvectors, then this becomes an invertible matrix. P inverse exists because these are linearly independent columns of a n by n matrix, and these are eigenvectors. So if I multiply A with P, that is equal to AV1, AVn, etc. But AV1 is lambda 1 V1. AVn is lambda n Vn. Okay. So this matrix is a product. This matrix is actually a product of this matrix AP is equal to D times P times D, where D is the diagonal matrix. Lambda 1, lambda n. So I multiply by P inverse and get that P inverse AP is equal to the diagonal matrix. Okay. So whenever my matrix A is similar to a matrix which is diagonal matrix, I say A is diagonalizable. And that is same as saying that there is a basis of eigenvectors, and the matrix whose column vectors are the eigenvectors has this property that P inverse AP is a diagonal matrix. Okay, and I also proved that the characteristic polynomial of a matrix and a matrix which is similar to it, okay, a matrix which is similar to it, C inverse AC. Okay, so C inverse AC, where C is invertible matrix, is similar to A, and the characteristic polynomial of a matrix and it's a matrix which is similar to it, they are also same. So characteristic polynomial doesn't change if I change the matrix to a similar matrix, and having a basis of eigenvectors is actually giving you a diagonal matrix which is similar to the given matrix A. So many properties of the given matrix are now reflected in a diagonal matrix. Diagonal matrices are very easy to study. Okay, so that's the importance of eigenvalues, eigenvectors to understand the action of matrices. So let us start from here. So we want to understand, have a general criteria for detecting when a matrix has a basis of eigenvectors or when a matrix is diagonalizable. So first we will learn a very general criterion, and then we will move to inner product spaces, and then use the properties of inner product spaces to give very concrete criterion. We will ultimately prove that Hermitian matrices and symmetric matrices will always have a basis of eigenvectors. Okay, in fact, they will have a basis of eigenvectors which are mutually perpendicular. Okay, but first we want to bring in inner product space little later. Today we just do what can you say in general for a matrix without using any concept of inner product. So suppose I have a linear operator of a finite dimensional vector space, and I want to understand, give a criterion for when there is a basis of eigenvectors of the vector space V for the linear transformation. So first we define the characteristic polynomial. The characteristic polynomial of this linear transformation to be PAX where A is any matrix of the linear transformation after you fix a basis. So every linear transformation from V to V will have a matrix once I fix the basis, because you operate the linear transformation on the basis vectors and get the matrix. Okay, get the matrix whose column vectors are coordinate vectors of TV1, TV2, TVn with respect to the basis B. Okay, so fix a basis, find the matrix of the linear transformation, and once you have a matrix, I can find out its characteristic polynomial. It is simply determinant of xi minus a. Okay, so but now you may ask, what happens if I change the basis? Well, that will not change the characteristic polynomial, because if I change the basis to another basis C, then we have proved before that the matrix of T with respect to the basis B and the matrix of T with respect to basis C, they are related by this equation. It is MBC, this is the change of basis matrix, and then MCT, and then the inverse. So matrix of T with respect to basis C and matrix of T with respect to basis B, they are similar matrices, and similar matrices have same characteristic polynomial. So therefore, it makes sense to talk about characteristic polynomial of any linear operator acting on finite dimensional vector space. Yeah, because it doesn't matter which basis you pick, different, if you change the basis, the matrix will become similar to the original matrix, and similar matrices have same characteristic polynomial. So we can talk about, without any ambiguity, we can talk about characteristic polynomial of a linear operator acting on a finite dimensional vector space. Okay, once I have the characteristic polynomial, the degree of the characteristic polynomial is the dimension of the vector space. Yeah, degree of the characteristic polynomial is dimension of the vector space on which the matrix is acting. And suppose this is n, then this is a degree n polynomial, and eigenvalues are the roots which are lying in the field of scalars. Yeah, not every root is a eigenvalue. Only those roots which are lying in the field of scalars are eigenvalues. Keep that in mind. Okay, so suppose mu belonging to the field of scalars is a root of f of x. Yeah, then find the maximum power of x minus mu which divides f of x. And suppose this is k. That means the k plus first power of x minus mu doesn't divide fx. So mu as a root of f of x has multiplicity k. Okay, so this number mu is called the algebraic multiplicity. Okay, this number is called the algebraic multiplicity of the eigenvalue mu. So if V is a finite dimensional vector space over a field of scalars, T is a linear operator, mu is an eigenvalue of T, then dimension of the eigenspace is called the geometric multiplicity. Okay, and the algebraic multiplicity is the multiplicity of mu as a root of the characteristic polynomial. So there are two multiplicities we are associating with every eigenvalue. Yeah, two multiplicity. One is the algebraic multiplicity, another is the geometric multiplicity. So with this eigenvalue, I have eigenspace V lambda, which consists of the zero vector and all eigenvectors. This vector space has certain dimension, and this dimension is called the geometric multiplicity of lambda. Okay, and the algebraic multiplicity of lambda is equal to max of the power, so which divides f of x. Okay, the characteristic polynomial PAX. Okay, so there is algebraic multiplicity and there is geometric multiplicity. Okay, they have a relationship between them, and the diagonalizability of a linear map or a matrix associated with a linear map, it can be characterized in terms of geometric multiplicity and algebraic multiplicity of each and every eigenvalue. Yeah, so let us